From my heart and from my hand, why don't people understand my intention?
Hello, my name is Elian Robles, and this is my 7th grade science fair project. My science fair project is what materials block a Wi-Fi signal. For this project, I use a Verizon Fios router, my phone, and these materials. These include a container filled with water, a plastic container, no water, tin foil, a steel baking pan, cardboard, and glass baking pan. And these materials were put in front of the router and were tested to find the Wi-Fi signal. To find the Wi-Fi signal, I used an app on my phone called iWi-Fi, and this app functions by hitting the start button, and it gives you the downloaded, and it gives you your ping, your download speed, and your upload speed. For this experiment, we used upload speed as our values for signal strength. First, you put two tables with your router on one and your phone on the other, and the same distance, or 4 feet apart, and 48 inches in height, so same height, and you begin your test by finding your control. So, you open the app, and you place your phone on the table in front of the router, and you start. You do this a total of 3 times for your control, and you jot down the upload speed that you got. Right? Then, you repeat this by putting each material in front of the router, and you do the same test, but this time, you have the material. You do this 3 times, and you repeat this for each material. Then, you find the average for all of the materials, and you also find what is called the attenuation, which is the average of your control, which would be without any materials in front of the router, subtracted by each material. After recording your data on a table, which should look like this, with all 3 trials for each material, the average, and the attenuation, you graph it in a bar graph, which looks like this, which each material and the different effect on the Wi-Fi signal. For the strength of each material, I found in my test that the container filled with water had the lowest average, which means that it affected the Wi-Fi strength the most, and the piece of cardboard affected the Wi-Fi the least. My hypothesis when originally beginning this experiment was that I thought that the steel baking pan would affect the Wi-Fi signal the most due to it being the strongest conductor of electricity. But after the experiment, I found out that the container filled with water actually affected the Wi-Fi strength the most. I believe this is due to the fact of difference in density, because if you look, the pan on the inside is much less thick than the container filled with water. So I think that's why it affected the Wi-Fi strength the most. Thank you for listening. Have a great day.
So, right on. Today I'll be presenting my miniature motor, which I will build it a little bit in front of you, but I already did the privilege to tape the paper clips to the edges of the battery. But also, what you want to do before taping them is you need to have jumbo paper clips without the rubber coating, so the electricity could run through it, and bend it so you could get this little tiny hole like right there. And then you tape them to the edge right here. Oh, the magnet. And tape them to the edge, like, to the edge right here. So the electricity can run through and affect the magnet wire. And then when you do that, you grab, like, two neodymium magnets and you place them in the center so it can spin. Like that. And I just used any type of tape that I just found. So I got electrical tape. And for the magnet wire, it was extremely hard to find it. So basically what I did, I just looked on Amazon and I bought it off of there, 28 gauge. And then once I got it, I used the Crayola markers, which the thick ones, not the thin ones, because they have to be the thick ones. And you just wrap it around, 10 times around the little cap. So it could get, this circular formation. And what also did so it could keep its circle formation is I looped the stem twice. I don't know if you can see it. I looped the stem twice. No. I looped the stems like twice, if you can see it right there. So it could stay in the circular formation like this. And then after what I did there, I grabbed sandpaper and I just took off all the red coating. You see the red coating right there? I took off all the red coating and I just started sanding it like this. And I started sanding it like this. And while you're sanding it, the stem also gets a little bit straight, but it curls up a little bit if you do it too much. So basically what I ended up doing is I went like this to keep it straight. And it ended up getting straight. And then I set up the motor and everything. And then I placed it through. And the motor starts spinning. This is actually the most it's ever spun before. But sometimes try not to touch the edge because it will electrocute you. I've learned the hard way by touching it many times. Many, many, many times. Yeah. And then, once you're done with all of that, then you get your homemade miniature motor.
Liquid. What can make ice melt the quickest? The materials that I need are a cupcake tray, salt, baking soda, maple syrup, 2 cracked egg yolks, milk, flour, sugar, 1/4 cup measurement, thermometer, and ice. Setting the experiment up, I will be placing all my ingredients into each hole, then I will put ice on top of each one and start observing. I hypothesize that the salt will melt the ice the quickest because of the sodium chloride inside will pull apart the ice particles and bring it to its water state. The milk will melt as if the ice is in water, but it will take longer than water and have a harder time melting due to the fact that milk is more dense. Flour will melt last due to the fact that ice and flour share the same freezing point, so ice tends to melt as if flour is not there and it was just left out by itself. Additionally, I think the flour will be wet on top but dry beneath because of how thick it is. Lastly, the flour will probably turn brownish because it is actually made of wheat. In my presentation, I will be using Celsius and 24-hour time. Data chart will be shown along the way and at the end. Additionally, I will be showing my observations of what the ice has done to each ingredient, and the room temperature is 22 degrees. At 3:08 p.m., the salt has successfully gone below the freezing point. Not many physical changes to the salt have occurred. But not too long after, the salt started making the bottom of the ice bumpy. This is because the salt is working on pulling apart the ice particles. At 3:11 p.m., the baking soda is inferior to the freezing point. Soon enough, I started to see that my flour hypothesis is correct, and the top is wet and the bottom and sides are completely dry. At 3:16, the maple syrup surprisingly is inferior to the freezing point. At 3:19 p.m., the sugar is below freezing point at negative 0.4 degrees. The sugar is working on lowering the freezing point of the ice. Additionally, the ice is melting into the sugar and it is not absorbing the water. This is because sugar only dissolves when shaken. The milk is negative 0.2 degrees at 3:34. Although the flour reached negative 0.1 degrees at 3:35 p.m., there is an exception. I put the thermometer on the wet part because, as mentioned earlier, the flour does not absorb all the water, only the top does. Coming in first, the salt has melted the ice at 3:37 p.m. It melted before the egg yolks have a chance to reach the freezing point. It melted at a temperature of negative 1.7 degrees. What I observed about the ice and the salt. The salt is absorbing the water and it also became rough and the majority of water stayed on top of the salt. Typically, salt absorbs water because it is an ionic compound. Salt is hygroscopic and absorbs water vapors and other liquids that are nearby. Egg yolks are last to reach the freezing point. No more than 5 minutes after the salt melted, milk melts at 3:42 p.m. with a temperature of 8.7 degrees. It is visibly watered down and lost density. Just 1 hour in, there are not many visual changes except for the egg yolks, which look more watered down. The sugar's colors have become darker. The flour is slowly changing colors. At 4 p.m., the maple syrup melts the ice. A noticeable pattern is that the liquids are melting the ice and bringing it below freezing point quicker than other ingredients besides for salt, and melts at 9.4 degrees. Some visible changes are the fact that the flour is slowly changing colors and it's dry on the sides, but wet wherever the ice has touched. The baking soda is turning into some sort of unusual slush. This is a physical change. While sugar is hygroscopic, just like salt, it is weaker and has a harder time absorbing the water. The ice has melted into the egg yolks at 4:03 p.m., but at 9.5 degrees. Once again, this proves my hypothesis of the liquid ingredients melting the ice first. No more than 6 minutes later, the sugar has melted the ice at 4.8 degrees. If sugar works similar to salt, why did it melt almost 40 minutes after? In the salt, there are more molecules, causing the ice to melt faster in salt. At 4:20 p.m., the baking soda melts the ice at a finishing temperature of 6.1 degrees. The baking soda turned into a mushy and snowy-looking texture. At 4:52 p.m., the ice melted in flour within a lapse time of 117 minutes. My hypothesis it was correct about the flour. Ice melts as it would regularly, as if the flour is not there. I left an ice cube on the side, not a part of my project, to test if my hypothesis would be true. And surely enough, the ice I left out melted only 3 more minutes after the flour ice had melted. Here are the results with the chart and the temperature when melted, the time elapsed. In conclusion, my hypothesis was correct, with the salt coming in first place and flour coming in last. This was very interesting to watch each ingredient go below freezing point and eventually melt, and a fun little contest. The reason that salt melts first is because it lowers the freezing point and pulls the molecules apart, bringing it to water state. The reason why all the liquids melted after salt before all the solids is because the liquids are hotter than ice. So it transfers to the ice and the ice melts. If I were to do this project again, I would use materials that can be found in cookies to see if they melt faster than the ones found in cake, this experiment.
My project was on how crystals formed using different saturated solutions. My hypothesis was if you make a saturated solution, put an impurity in it, and let it cool, then crystals will form. This is due to solubility. Solubility is how much of something that can be dissolved in another thing, usually water. Solubility increases with temperature, and that means as your solution cools, the temperature drops, and this means solubility drops. This means that there's more sugar or salt than your water can physically hold, and your crystals start looking for impurities to grow on. These impurities can be anything from a speck of dust to a scratch in the container or a piece of string. The bigger your impurity is, the faster your crystals will grow because they have more surface area to grow on. I use three different types of minerals for my crystals. I use potassium aluminum sulfate, otherwise known as alum, sugar, and Epsom salt. My alum crystals did not form very well, and they were extremely small and also dissolved fairly quickly. My Epsom salt crystals grew fairly quickly, taking about 10 hours to fully form. They are very thin, resembling shards of ice. My sugar crystals also grew fairly quickly, and they grew to about the size of a quarter. This shows that my hypothesis was supported because my solutions formed crystals due to the process of crystallization. There are many ways in which I could have improved my experiment. I could have used different impurities. I could have also put them in different places like nearby a window or in a refrigerator. Finally, I could have also used different containers to see if that would have affected my crystals in any way.
My name is Mia Fowler.
And I'm Emma Brongo.
And welcome to our 2021 Science Fair project in which we are building and using a solar-powered oven. Professional solar ovens are often used as an eco-friendly way to cook food compared to other grills that, to work, need gases and fuels that pollute the area and smell. With solar ovens, you don't need any gas, just the sun. They go up to typically 600 degrees Fahrenheit and are very easy to use. However, for our project, we won't be buying a solar oven, but making ones ourselves. We both made separate solar ovens and tested them out to see their efficiency. Even though we aren't using proper ovens made out of steel, we can still cook our food by attracting radiant energy via the three main components of solar cooking: concentration, absorption, and retention. I'll pass it over to you, Emma.
Radiant energy, also sometimes called visible light, is a type of electromagnetic wave. In the electromagnetic spectrum, it is between infrared rays and ultraviolet rays, or UV rays, and travels the fastest in the spectrum. Solar ovens don't actually need the warmth of the sun, but the light rays, which also include UV rays. Solar ovens trap the UV rays and stretch them out so they cannot escape. UV rays also have the right energy to heat up the molecules in the food to cook it. Radiant energies and UV rays are attracted to the solar oven by the three main components of solar cooking: concentration, absorption, and retention. Back to you, Mia.
Thank you. Now, what are the three main components to solar cooking? The first is concentration, which directs heat by reflection, which is why we're using aluminum foil on both the insides of our boxes and the lids. The next is absorption, the ability to attract and hold heat. This is why Emma is using black painted aluminum foil in her oven, since black and dark colors absorb heat. This is why winter clothing is often in darker shades, and also why my mom continuously tells me that black turtlenecks aren't the best thing to wear in the summer, but it's a fashion statement. In our experiment, both of my items I attempted to cook came out undercooked compared to Emma's, which is most likely because of her use of black tin foil. Last, we have retention, which is the ability to trap heat. This is why we are building an additional lid to keep our egg nice and cooked and our water bubbly and boiling. Speaking of that, in our experiment, we attempted to fry an egg and boil 1 cup of water. I fried and boiled both of my items on the same day Emma boiled her water, which makes it easy to compare them. However, Emma fried her egg on a day that was fairly warm out but very cloudy. And because of this, her egg came out undercooked and soupy no matter how long she left it. The purpose of the three main components is to attract sunlight to your oven, so it can then be transformed into heat. But if there isn't any sun in the first place, you won't be able to cook your food. This is an issue we faced even when we tested our other items out on a sunny day with nice weather. Emma's water got much closer to boiling than I did, but still never got there. All this to say that while yes, weather is a big component, sunlight is by far the most crucial part of this experiment. Which seems like a given, but to really efficiently make your own meal when using a solar oven, you need to make sure the oven has enough access to sunlight, enough time with enough sunlight, and that you're using the three main components of solar cooking to attract as much sunlight as possible. Can radiant energy be used to heat up food? Absolutely. And this is proved by Emma steaming water to my sticky egg and the physical changes of these items under the sunlight. Can radiant energy be used to cook food? Well, if you have the right amount of sunlight, then yes. Thank you so much for the applause that I can most definitely hear. This has been Mia Fowler and Emma Brongo's 2021 Science Fair project. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Paul Maridi, and this is my project. Well, this isn't my whole project, just the finished product. For my Science Fair 2021 project, I designed, built, and tested a balloon-powered car. These are all the materials required to make the car. As you can see, everything here is a household item. The most complicated thing here on the table was a handheld power drill, which was operated by my father, as there is always a certain danger in using a power tool. This is a photo of the drilling of a hole in the wheel, which was a bottle cap. Remember this photo, it'll become relevant later. This is a photo of how the axle, a skewer, was connected to the main body of the car. In actuality, the axle isn't connected. It's actually inside of a straw, which is taped to the car. This is because if the axle was taped, it couldn't rotate. This is a small deviation from the procedure, because having two pieces originally planned would make keeping the axle straight harder. Here are two videos of the car rolling with the wheels attached to the axle. It is not the straightest, and this was caused by the wheels turning on the axles. We fixed this problem by lowering the wheel size and changing the drill bit from earlier, which was a little bit too big for the wheel to stay onto the axle. These are three of the 10 5-feet tests in which I timed how long the car took to go 5 feet. These were done with the new smaller wheels. Also, one thing that these tests showed was that the car curves off to the left every time. Overall, the average time it took to go 5 feet was 3.03 seconds. The next video was from the second group of tests. The purpose of these tests was to measure how far the car went in 15 seconds. The average distance the car went in 15 seconds was 16.02 feet. This was the attempt right after test number 4. As you can see, it never started. This was because the straw became too wet from a slightly improper inflation technique, which let a little spit in. The straw was cleaned as best as possible without detaching it, but the next two tests didn't go nearly as far. After those two, the straw and balloon were replaced, which skyrocketed the results. That is all. Thank you for listening, and have a nice day.
How Does a DC Motor Work? By Alan Carvalho. This is a DC motor. It uses a combination of electricity, magnetism, and electromagnetism to work. What are the parts of a DC motor? This is the brush. It is directly connected to the battery, and the brush transfers energy to the communicator, but it is not wired to the communicator to transfer energy. This is the communicator. It transfers energy to the copper wire and makes the copper electronically charged. The rod is the ammeter. It is what spins in the DC motor. This is the body of the DC motor. There are two magnets of opposite direction that help the DC motor spin, and those two magnets are called the stator. How does a DC motor work? When energy goes through a brush, it passes the energy to the communicator. The communicator then transfers it to the wires. Because of the current going through the wires have now become an electromagnet. Because there is a magnetic field circling the wires, it starts spinning. Because the magnetic field of the stator and ammeter produce torque, or acceleration, and spin because of something called the left-hand rule.
My science fair project is extracting DNA from strawberries. My investigative question was, which stage of a strawberry's growth has the most DNA? Assuming not much is known about my topic, I'll give some background information on it. First of all, strawberries are octoploids. They have 8 copies of each chromosome. This is good because it means that there is a lot of DNA to isolate, which is one reason why strawberries are a good fruit to extract DNA from. Secondly, DNA is a molecule that contains the instructions an organism needs to develop, live, and reproduce. This is what I extracted. Lastly, a chromosome is a long DNA molecule with sum to all of the genetic material of an organism. It carries genetic information in the form of genes. Moving on, the purpose of this experiment is to take the results and see how closely related different species of organisms are, or to check for any mutations. Speaking of results, the amount of DNA found in underripe strawberries was 1/6, 1/8, and 1/2 teaspoon. The amount of DNA found in ripe strawberries was 1/2, 1/2, and 1/3 teaspoon, and the amount of DNA found in overripe strawberries was 1/4, 1/3, and 1/3 teaspoon. This information showed that ripe strawberries yield the most DNA. My hypothesis, which stated, if I extract DNA from different stages of strawberries, then I predict that the ripe strawberries will extract the most DNA because strawberries reach their peak of maturity at this time, turned out to be correct. This is because underripe strawberries are too young to generate DNA cells, and overripe strawberries start decomposing at this point, meaning that they both don't yield much DNA.
Go to my project. How do different liquids affect plant growth? Using different liquids on plants than water can have a big effect on how we grow things today. Because if soda or sparkling water makes a plant grow faster than water, then they could sell more every year. And if it makes a plant taste better, then they could sell them for more money and maximize profits. This could revolutionize the farming industry. Crust plants grow in cool temperatures. They need a lot of water to grow. They are harvestable after about 15 days, and the plants sprout out after 3 days. The reason why they grow so fast is because since they aren't in the sunlight for a long time, they don't have to use all their energy in photosynthesis. Instead, they use it to grow. Since they don't focus all their energy to photosynthesis, they need a lot of water, which means that using a different liquid will have a greater effect on the impact of the growth on the growth of the plants. This is why these plants are perfect for this experiment. The liquids that will be used is Coca-Cola, sparkling water, vitamin water, and tap water. The main ingredient in Coca-Cola are sugar and water. Like every plant, crust needs water, and adding sugar is like giving it more energy. So Coca-Cola sounds like a great alternative water source for the crust, until you start to factor in all the ingredients that are used in a Coca-Cola. The ingredients in question are caffeine, aspartame, and sucralose. Caffeine actually starts out helpful to plants. Like humans, it makes the plant more ready and hyperactive. What I mean is that it accelerates the process of photosynthesis and it absorbs the nutrients and water from the soil much faster. The problem comes in after a few days. The caffeine will make the soil's pH level go down, and some plants can die from the acidity change. And the caffeine can also start to kill cells. Aspartame and sucralose aren't that bad, it's just they can be bad, because plants need sugar, and artificial sugar confuses plants, so they discard about 90% of the fake sugar, but sometimes they can discard the good sugar as well. Sparkling water is made by injecting carbon dioxide under pressure. Sparkling water usually has a lot of added minerals and some salt to improve taste. Since crust needs minerals and water, this sounds like a godsend, and it is. Sparkling water is used by gardeners to boost the plant's growth, strength, and greenness. The minerals in the sparkling water are absorbed by the plants, and they make the plants grow strong and healthy. Vitamin mix. A lot of people start the day off by combining it with water and drinking it, because it is beneficial to humans with or without vitamin deficiencies. But are they good for humans? Are they good for plants too? The answer is, it depends. If you're using vitamin A, B1, B12, B100, C, and D, it should definitely be helpful. These vitamins help the plant grow, but it also builds up its defenses against fungus and insects. Most vitamin powders also include sugar, which helps the plant even more on top of that. Here I have a chart. As you can see, Coca-Cola made it to 2 inches, while sparkling water made it to 3. And so did vitamin water, it made it to 3. While water made it grow to 4 inches. Although water made the plants grow longer, the vitamin water definitely made the plants much stronger than water, but not as long, and it made the crust sprout more leaves. Sparkling water made the crust grow the healthiest and strongest. Sparkling water also made more leaves grow. Coca-Cola had almost the same results as water, only that it didn't grow as long. In conclusion, although water made the plants grow faster, sparkling water and vitamin water made the plants far more green and made the stems thicker and longer, indicating that they were healthier than when water was given. Sparkling water definitely made the healthiest and greenest one. This means that if you're farming in an area with bad soil, a lot of bugs, and the fungus infestation, it would be wise to go with sparkling water. If you're just growing in your house, stick with water. The little disclaimer, the stuff you're about to see is not to scale. Ticks and numbers are for visual representation only. For Coca-Cola, it grew to 2 inches as displayed here. Sparkling water to 3. Vitamin water to 3. And water to 4.
Hello, my name is Anthony Pantaleone. This is my science fair project, The Reason for the Seasons. I started off by attaching a light on top of a cardboard box. I then taped graph paper to a sturdy wooden box. I used a protractor to make sure I had my angles correct when I started to increase my tilts. Starting at 0 degree tilt and using colored pencil, I traced the circle of light that appeared on the graph paper. During the summer in North America, the sunlight is very concentrated due to the tilt of the Earth. This is exactly what I saw at the 0 degree tilt. I then increased my tilt by 10 degrees and drew another circle. At my 20 degree tilt, you can start to notice that as I increased the degree of tilt, the number of squares inside the outline are also increasing. Tilting next to 30 degrees, you can see that the line is becoming more spread out. Even more so with the 40 degree tilt, this is when the light is similar to what North America experiences during our winter. The light is very spread out and not as concentrated as the 0 degree tilt. I repeated these steps 2 more times for a total of 3 graphs. Then I take my ruler and count every box within the circles, documenting each square as 25 hundredths, 50 hundredths, 75 hundredths, and one whole. I record my findings on a chart along with the average number of squares from the 3 graphs. Using the averages, I then created a line graph that shows the number of squares had increased as the degree of tilt, providing that the lower or no degree tilt has a more concentrated light. Summer and a larger tilt produces a more spread out tilt. Winter.
I hope you enjoyed my project. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Erica Rez. Today I would gladly present to you my balloon powered car. You may ask, how is this balloon powered and how does it work? Well, as you can see, a deflated balloon does not store any energy at all, not even potential energy. But when I inflate the balloon, now the balloon stores potential energy because the air pressure inside expands the latex. Now, when I release it though, the car would be moving forward, creating kinetic energy. And this principle is based on Newton's third law of motion, stating that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Now, I have thought through I went through many designs to a water bottle base to CD wheels. But with the materials that I had at home and what I thought would work best, I went with a cardboard base, the classic straw and balloon, of course, and I went with wooden skewers, and I'm not going to say wooden skewers because they're actually 3 toothpicks hot glued together, creating a long toothpick per se. And finally, I used bottled cap wheels. So let's talk about the axle and the function of the wheels. So what I did was, there's actually a straw, as you could see, and I didn't want to just glue the wooden axles because, as many of you guys would have guessed, the wooden axles wouldn't move and the wheels wouldn't work at all, meaning that the car wouldn't move and the car wouldn't have any function whatsoever. But by putting the DIY wooden skewer into the straw, letting it move freely like so, it could help have my results much better and the car would move much more efficiently. So I just classically taped the straw with the wooden skewer and wheels, actually hot glued with another piece of toothpick outside, so it would move more efficiently and make sure it doesn't break apart. And of course, I put the straw around a little bit wider than the cardboard box so the wheels wouldn't touch, because if the wheels were touching like this, it would cause friction, making it to move slower or not even move at all. Now let's talk about my results. It's moved in 10 seconds, it moved 30 feet. So that means, saying that, it moved 3 feet per second in a straight. Thank you so much for your time and have a great day.
Hello, my name is Francesca Muir and this is my science fair project. So the whole purpose of this experiment was to answer this one simple question, which is, when mixed with water, which liquid will make the best invisible to most showing ink using oxidation?
So basically my hypothesis was, if I created invisible ink using vinegar with water and lemon juice with water, I predict that lemon juice and water creates the best invisible ink that goes from invisible to very clear the best.
I believe this because lemon juice is a citric acid and will probably respond to heat better. But first, for my hypothesis, I had to identify my control and my variable. And the control was lemon juice or vinegar, and my variable was the clearer ink. So the scientific definition of oxidation is really just the addition of oxygen. And in chemistry, oxidation is really just the loss of electrons in a reaction by molecules, atoms, or ions. To explain the degradation of ascorbic acid in depth would mean that ascorbic acid is really just the scientific name for vitamin C, and vitamin C is found in common citrus fruits like lemons and oranges, and the degradation is really just the breaking down. So the degradation of ascorbic acid is just the breaking down of vitamin C and fruits and citruses and stuff like that. Of course, the two liquids are very different, vinegar and lemon juice, and the science behind them are different as well, because vinegar is an acidic acid and lemon juice is an ascorbic acid. So the science would be very different, and the research and the way the project works would work differently for each of them due to the fact that they're so different. So for the experiment part of this project, I tested each liquid 5 times, and in the data charts, those are the averages of what they came out to. So 40% of it was paper change, which means that it did change in color, and it did have change, but it wasn't that drastic. It was just like the crumbling of the paper. 50% didn't change at all, which happened a lot. And 10% was a color change, which they changed slightly in color, actually, which was actually the part of the experiment that was supposed to happen, my hypothesis, which didn't turn out the way I planned. So this was the first time for the vinegar. You could kind of see I wrote vinegar and I wrote hello, and then yeah, and then you could kind of see that it like went to it. You could see during the drying there was writing here. It was completely like flat, so once it was applied to a heat source, it kind of crinkled to it. And then you could see for the lemon juice, it did the same thing. Yeah, it looks very different from when it was drying after it was applied to the heat source. Here are some more examples. So this was the vinegar part. I tested a total of 5 times, and then this was actually really one of my favorites, because if you look closely, you can actually see a color change in that one. So I thought that was pretty cool, because that was one of the rare times that it happened. So yeah, as you can see, the lemon just did come out a little clearer, and actually color changed once. So yeah, it kind of shows. And then there's other cases where nothing happened again. And then from the beginning, I knew that I thought lemon juice was going to work better, but I don't know, because the vinegar was more clear from the beginning, so that sort of confused me and, like, test my theories a little bit, because the vinegar and water was a lot clearer from the beginning, opposed to the lemon juice. So I basically mixed the two components following, like, the procedure. I mixed the two components, and then I dipped in a paintbrush, and then I wrote on the paper with a secret message. For some of them, I let them dry and then I applied them to the heat source. And some of them, I didn't let them dry and I applied right away. I couldn't tell if there was a difference to this process or if all the results came out the same when I did that. But it just made sense to see which ones came out better. In the end, my project definitely didn't turn out the way I thought it would. I expected the liquids to go from invisible to, like, very visible on the paper, which that didn't happen. That only happened, like, 10% of the time, which is a very small amount, because that happened with one letter, maybe, throughout the whole time that I wrote. In the beginning, they were completely invisible on the paper, like, when I first wrote them. But when I added the heat source, the paper kind of crumbled to it, which happened majority of the time, and it also didn't change a lot. So that was pretty interesting. And for this, obviously the results weren't what I wanted, and I hoped for a more drastic change, but the science of it worked out, and the procedures and the experiment I did, and that seemed pretty accurate to me. In conclusion, this project was to test which ink would work better with lemon juice and vinegar mixed with water, which to see which would go best from invisible ink to completely clear on paper to write secret messages. So I was very surprised with my results. I thought the lemon juice would work best, as shown in my hypothesis, and it did, but it didn't, because neither of them really worked the way I wanted them to. But I mean, the science worked out and the results are accurate upon the research. I was surprised by the results, obviously, and this wasn't what I wanted to happen. I did come in contact with a major issue that, like, my heat source wasn't really what I expected it to do and what I wanted it to be, but I mean, it all worked out in the end. The results are very interesting. Obviously, the paper didn't change color. It's more of the paper changing itself, not physical form. I have to say, the vinegar was clear in the beginning, but the lemon juice did work better in the end. So, in conclusion, these two liquids to me are household liquids and not spy gear.
Build a solar-powered car by Alexander Kim. For my science fair project, I made a solar-powered car. The car was made from cardboard, a solar panel, motor, and wheels. I chose to make a solar-powered car because I thought it would be hard, fun, and interesting. The materials used were a motor, wheels, cardboard, a solar panel, drinking straws, tape, alligator clips, gears, bearings, and axles. The procedure. First, I put the axle into the straw and attached it to the cardboard. I then attached the gear to the motor and the wheel. Then, I taped the motor to a piece of cardboard. I meshed up the gears on the motor and wheel so when the motor gets powered, the gear moves. I then attached the solar panel to the cardboard. Finally, I attached alligator clips to the solar panel and motor. Sources.
My science fair project was about measuring your own taste threshold. If you don't know what your taste threshold is, it's basically the lowest amount of a substance that we can taste from. Meaning that if I consume a lower amount of a substance than its taste threshold, I wouldn't be able to taste it. And if I consume the exact amount or more of the taste threshold for a certain substance, I would be able to taste it. In my experiment, I tried to find the taste threshold for cane sugar, kosher salt, sea salt, and vinegar. As you can see, I used two different types of salts. That's because I predicted that two different kinds of salts would have two different kinds of outcomes, which turned out to have the same threshold, and my prediction was unfortunately wrong. My hypothesis, on the other hand, was correct. My hypothesis was, if I put the salt, sugar, and vinegar on my tongue following the tongue map, then I will taste those certain flavors the most on certain regions of my tongue because different regions of my tongue are sensitive to different types of flavors. If you don't know what the tongue map looks like, which is shown on the screen, it's pretty much a map of your tongue showing all the different regions that are most sensitive to different types of flavors. During my experiment, I've taken a picture during my process, which is shown on the screen here. This image is showing all the cups and substances mixed together, which I have repetitively done for all the different tests. After finishing the experiment, the results ended up having pretty low thresholds, which was surprising for me because I thought the substances would have a higher threshold than they would have turned out to be, especially the salt thresholds. Meanwhile, with the sugar threshold, I was surprised that the sugar's threshold was pretty far apart from the salt taste threshold. After finishing the salts test and doing the sugars, the cane sugar's taste threshold was very high with a threshold of 2 grams compared to the salt threshold, which was only 5/10 grams for both kosher and sea salt. The last thing I will be talking about is my investigative question, which was, what would be the taste threshold for sugariness, saltiness, and sourness? Fortunately, I was able to answer my question with my data table showing all the information I have collected during my experiment. Thank you for listening to my science fair presentation, and I hope you have an amazing rest of your day.
It's a bit true, adding sugar into plants' water will increase its growth. In my experiment, I'll be adding sugar into plants' water to see if it'll increase its growth. The first thing in this experiment, I found out how the plant works. The plant goes through a process called photosynthesis, and in that process, it goes through oxidation. At the end, their food is created, which is called glucose, plant's food. And there's actually lots of different kinds of sugar. And glucose is a monosaccharide, which is one sugar molecule. And another one sugar molecule, or monosaccharide, is fructose. And fructose is sugar that's from, like, fruits, essentially, and, like, sugar cane and other different kinds of foods. And sucrose, the sugar that I will be adding into the plant's water, is a mix of fructose and glucose, which are both monosaccharides. So when it mixes together, it's called this disaccharide, which is a combination of two monosaccharides. And it actually, sucrose being a disaccharide is helpful because part of it is glucose already. So it should probably help because it's a combination, I guess, of it. And yeah. Adding fructose may or may not help. I didn't find any information on whether or not it did, but it did show that it does have a negative impact on a human body. It can cause like diabetes and fatty liver disease, but generally in humans, a lot of sugar isn't the best for it. Also, a lot of food that we eat and drink actually help plants as well. Like milk and different other stuff as well. My hypothesis is if sugar is added into the plant into the water that a plant requires, I predict that the plant's growth would increase because of the sugar is a food that green plants use to grow. And for my experiment, I use a tomato plant, and yeah. Also, I will be showing the process that I do every morning to feed the plants. First, I add 50 milliliters of this water that's clean, I guess. Then into one of them, I add okay, once I make sure that I mix it all the way until there's no grains of sugar. And I just added the plants every single day. This one is for this one. And this one's for this one. Also, every morning I throw out the old water. What are the results? So, in the beginning, no sugar plants. They were doing really good, and they wilted a little bit on the edges, but they still are doing good right now. Meanwhile, the sugar ones, they aren't doing the best. At first, they were doing good, and then the bottom leaves turned a little bit yellow, and the leaf turned entirely yellow, and it fell off, and then the rest of the plants started wilting, and they basically aren't doing the best. In conclusion, in this experiment, adding sugar into plant's water will not increase its growth. During my experiment, I found out that normal plants without the sugar actually grow much better than the ones that do, and that in fact that they actually do wilt and eventually do die instead of growing.
Hi, my name is Natalie Alvin, and this is my science fair project. I'm working with the spherification of certain acidic liquids like soda, carbonated beverages, and certain types of juice. So the first thing that we need for the project is a calcium chloride solution using 2 grams, exactly 2 grams, of calcium chloride and 1 cup of water. It's a type of salt, so make sure that it is completely dissolved in the water. Okay, so now that the calcium chloride is dissolved in the water, measure out 2 grams of sodium alginate with a digital scale, and then measure out 1/2 cup of whatever acidic liquid you're using. We're using orange soda. Then add that to whatever you're blending it in. Then add another 1/2 cup. We are using
and emerge in Blender. So see you in a second. After blending, this is what it should look like if you're using a soda. Depending on the liquid that you're using, it could be thicker or thinner than this, but this one, if you're using a soda, it's most likely going to be more like syrup. And if you blend for a minute or two, it's going to have a little bit of foam at the top. So take your syringe, take a considerable amount out, and then add it in little droplets to the other solution, like that. You can make them a little bit bigger, a little bit smaller. It's a little hard to make them big, and I'm just gonna make 5 to show you now. That is 6, not 5. Okay, so I'm gonna make 6 to show you now, and that is what they should look like. So right now I'm just separating the last of the bunch. One thing that I forgot to mention was that each ball of a different size should be in there for a certain amount of time. If you're making tiny ones, they should be in there, I think, anywhere from like 15 to 30 seconds. They really shouldn't be in there that long, otherwise they get discolored, and that's not what you want. If they're bigger, then you should leave them in there for about 60 seconds. A little more, a little less won't hurt. And this is what they should look like. Bigger ones are hard to make, but if you use a spoon, then they can be pretty easy. So this is one of the better looking ones. It looks a little bit like a bean, but this is pretty much how they're supposed to look if you've made them well. They shouldn't be too firm. They should be a little bit squishy, and they should pop in your mouth. So in conclusion, you should really try this out. It's a really fun project to do. The chemicals are really not that dangerous. You just have to soak them in water after putting them in the calcium chloride solution because it's a tiny bit bitter. But other than that, you'll be okay. You can measure them like this. This one's one of the more perfect ones. Just put it on the graph paper, make sure it's lined up. And this one is good. So, thank you for watching. This was my science fair project.
Hi, my name's Nicholas, and this is about my project for the science fair. So, what my project is about creating these papers, which you would know as litmus papers, and dipping them into liquids, which will reveal its pH. So, the thing that I did was I took the red cabbage, I sliced the leaves off, and I put them in a pot. I poured hot water into it and let it boil for 30 minutes and cool down. I put it through a strainer and into a cup, and I let the scientific filter papers soak for overnight. After that, I started getting these liquids ready and I dipped them. And as you can see, I dip in the lemon juice, it turns red, which works, which is great. So, the reason why I did this project was to strengthen my knowledge into chemistry and just understanding pH as a whole, because I didn't know chemistry at all before this project, and after I did it, it helped me a lot. Now, the reason why pH is so important is that we can measure it, and we can measure its acidity and basicity. Now, both are good for us, but sometimes it's not good. Say you have an outdoor pool, it's too acidic, and you can measure how much it has. Also, pollution in water makes it more acidic, and that's the reason why. So, basically, how I measured it, I took these and I dipped it in, but I found out that it was a bit inaccurate, so I decided to use these, too. And I got a bit more, you know, acceptable results. And when I was finished, I graphed it here. As you can see, distilled water, milk, lemon juice, orange juice, vinegar, salt water. Over here is 7, which is neutral. Under 7 would be acidic, and over 7 would be alkaline. And as you can see right here, here's my substances, here's the levels. And that was pretty much what I was going through. Now to the vocabulary, which we had all these. The litmus paper is a tool that's used to measure pH. And the reason why I got this was because of the red cabbage. And in the red cabbage leaves, it has a pigment. And the pigment, when in contact with either acidic or basic liquids, it changes color. So it starts out as like a violet, and as you saw with the lemon juice, it turned red, so that means lemon juice is acidic. So, yeah, that's basically what I was thinking, and I also got a lot different results than I expected. I thought orange juice is going to be way more red. And that was pretty much it. It was really a good project that I like to go through, and I recommend it to anyone if they want to learn a bit about chemistry. Thanks for watching.
Your project is called paper chromatography. Is black ink really black? My instigative question was, are black markers really black? Now you're probably thinking about what chromatography even is. Well, here's some background information about it. Chromatography is the separation of mixture. The word chromatography gets its name from a technique first used in the late 19th century to separate pigments in a mixture. It was invented in 1903 by a Russian botanist. Chromatography means color writing and was originally used for the separation of plant pigments such as chlorophyll and carotenoids. This is also called the solvent. Black Crayola markers produce green pigment, black ballpoint pens produce blue and purple pigment, and Sharpies produce orange and yellow pigment. The results showed that when the black Crayola marker produced green pigment, it produced the most color out of the three. In conclusion, my hypothesis was correct. My hypothesis said, if I put black ink in both water and isopropyl alcohol, then I predict color will show clearly because both substances react well together. This was true because when you mix isopropyl alcohol and water together, the alcohol molecules will bond with the water molecules.
Hello, my name is Pablo Tejada, and this is my science fair entry. The project that I have chosen to do will lead me to see which filtration material is best for drinking water. The materials that I have chosen are powdered carbon and sand. Reasoning is because I know that carbon is used in many of today's filters, and sand is surrounded by water at the beach, so what could go wrong? The liquids that I will be combining with our materials will be undyed tap water, lightly dyed tap water, and heavily dyed tap water. Our goal is to completely take the color out of the dye. We mix the lightly dyed tap water with the carbon, the same with the sand, and the heavily dyed tap water with the carbon, and same with the sand. Here are the results, and they may shock you, as you can see by the following pictures. The carbon completely took out the color for both the heavily dyed and the lightly dyed tap water, and the sand only slightly took it away. However, for the undyed tap water, it did make the water a tad bit dark, and the sand just did absolutely nothing. And here's my data table showing you from the start to the finish. 0 will show you how light it is, and 10 will show you how dark it is. The undyed tap water went through the carbon filter and ended up with a 2 because it did, as I said before, make it a tad bit darker. And the sand did absolutely nothing, so it stayed a 0. For the lightly dyed tap water, it was originally a 7, and when it went through the carbon filter, it was a 1 because it was still slightly dark. And through the sand filter, it ended up a 5. And the heavily dyed water, the carbon filter completely took out the dye, and the sand filter still left it as if it was lightly dyed tap water. These are my results, and I hope you enjoyed my science fair entry. Goodbye!
My project was about testing which part of my house holds the most amount of bacteria. I tested the kitchen, the living room, and the bathroom. My hypothesis was that the bathroom would contain the most amount of bacteria and have more bacterial growth due to it's where people wash their hands there and do most of their hygiene routine there. How I performed the experiment was to put agar into 6 different petri dishes and waited for it to freeze. Then I got a cotton swab and swabbed the 3 locations 2 times each to prevent any mishaps. After swabbing the bacteria onto the agar plates, I taped the petri dishes shut so I don't breathe into the bacterial air as it could cause people to feel ill. The reason why I put agar on the petri dishes is because it gives the nutrients for the bacteria to strive and grow rapidly. More bacterial growth and colonies mean the more dirty a location was. After testing my hypothesis, I was actually right. Both the bathroom petri dishes contained more smaller and way more bacterial growth than the other 2 locations. The kitchen and living room had around the same size bacteria colonies, but the kitchen visually had a little more growth than the living room. So the bathroom was the most dirtiest, followed by the kitchen, then the living room. How I could have improved is to have moved my box into a more hot environment instead of warm to increase more faster growth. If I had even more time, I would have seen more bacterial growth in each petri dish.
My name is Sua Jun, and the science fair project that I have decided to conduct is the water surface tension. The question I decided to come up with was which side of a dam will hold more droplets of water before breaking the surface tension. The hypothesis I have came up with is if I drop 20 drops on the head side of a dam, then I predict that it will break surface tension because the head side of a dam has a protruding design as opposed to the tail side. And this is the research I have conducted over the period of time. And then the materials that I would need are one dime, 1 pipe bit, 1 cup of water, 1 paper, 1 pencil, and 2 napkins. The procedure I would be doing would be, first I would gather all the necessary materials to use during my experiment. Next, I would fold a napkin 2 times and place the head side of the dime onto it. Next, I would fill 1 cup of tap water. And then I'll fill the pipe bit full of water until no more water can be contained. Next, I'll try to get as much of the air bubbles from the pipe bit out as possible. And then after that, I will carefully drop water droplets onto the dime while counting. And then after the surface tension breaks, I'll dry off the wet area of the dime, then flip it over onto the tail side, onto the new napkin. And then I'll repeat the same procedure. And then the results I have gotten is that it took 25 water droplets before breaking the surface tension, and then it took 27 water droplets before breaking the surface tension on the tail side. So then in conclusion, my hypothesis states that if I drop 20 drops on the head side of a dime, then I predict that it will break surface tension because the head side of a dime has a protruding design as opposed to the tail side. My hypothesis was incorrect. It took 25 water droplets on the head side of the dime to break the surface tension.
So for this science fair this year, I built a solar oven. Mine was made from a pizza box, but it can also be made from a Pringles jar or shoebox. Some people actually buy professional solar ovens for their day-to-day lives. These people might worry about the earth since gas stoves tend to use fossil fuels in order to work, which then releases greenhouse gases that are harmful for the earth. and electric stoves consume a lot of energy. Some people who live in rural communities might use solar energy to power their daily necessities, like a solar oven or a solar panel that converts sunlight to electrical energy to either cool or heat their houses. Other people might want to travel in places that there aren't gas or electric stoves readily available to them. The way it works is that it uses solar energy that is then converted to heat energy. This happens through the reflection of the aluminum foil. The aluminum foil is on top of the flap and it reflects onto the base of the box, and over time it heats up. The base is made to be able to retain and hold heat inside of it. It has plastic wrap over the opening, like how an oven has a door to prevent the heat from escaping. It also has newspaper to insulate the base, like how when houses have insulation in the framing of the houses to make sure that in the winter people who live there don't freeze. It also has black construction paper because the color black absorbs heat better than any other color, so it's ideal to have it on the bottom. The furthest project, the food that was used was chocolate caramel on top of a granola bar. It had started melting after 2 hours, more or less, and it felt hot to the touch. It didn't become super liquidy, but it became mushy to the point where the inside of the chocolate was pulling onto the container. It did take quite a bit of time for it to start melting and start getting to a point where the consistency was malleable, but it eventually did start to melt. The weather of the day that was testing was somewhat cloudy at first, and then it got windy. After some time, the sun was barely visible and it was just windy and cloudy. The chocolate would have melted more if the sun had been stronger that day. And the first trial run, it had started to get really cloudy and raining and it just wouldn't work. So the chocolate barely melted. It was just like, it was just soft. And when it comes to solar ovens and cookers, the weather has to actually be warm and sunny for it to work in general. And it could certainly cause problems for people who plan to use it, but can't be waiting around for it to gather enough heat or for the climate to clear. People who live in colder places and where there isn't as much sunlight or have busy lives might be less likely to be using solar cookers or solar ovens out of convenience.
The name of my science fair project is Bath Bomb Science. My investigative question was, how does changing the amounts of different ingredients in homemade bath bombs affect their fizziness? Before getting started, let me explain how bath bombs work. The chemical reaction of the bath bombs fizzing when touching the water happens when baking soda and citric acid undergo a chemical reaction when mixed with water. Since the baking soda, also known as sodium bicarbonate, is a weak base and citric acid is a weak acid, the acid-base reaction produces carbon dioxide gas. This gas is what makes the fizzy bubbles when the bath bombs touches the water. The role of cornstarch in homemade bath bombs is that it can act as a dry filler that gets mixed with in the reactive baking soda and citric acid components in the bombs. Cornstarch in bath bombs helps slow down the reaction of the bath bombs by binding together the baking soda and citric acid. It makes the bath bombs dissolve more slowly. Therefore, the fizziness may last for 3 or 4 minutes instead of for only a few seconds. In this experiment, I tested one normal bath bomb recipe and the second recipe that has extra cornstarch added to it to find out how changing the amount of cornstarch filler affects the reaction rate of the bath bomb, or in other words, how the amount of cornstarch affects the fizziness of the bath bombs. The reaction rate for a chemical reaction is a measurement of how quickly the reaction happens, or how quickly the reactants the baking soda and citric acid for the bath bombs create the reaction's products, which includes carbon dioxide bubbles for the bath bombs. The faster bath bomb dissolves, the more carbon dioxide it is making, the fizzier it is, and the faster the reaction is taking place. My hypothesis stated, if I add less cornstarch filler in the bath bomb, then I predict that the bomb will be fizzier because the filler, which is the cornstarch, will change the chemical reactions of the remaining ingredients. I was correct. The results showed that the average reaction rates for the normal bath bombs, the ones with less cornstarch, had a faster reaction rate than the bath bombs with extra cornstarch. This is because the cornstarch slows down the reaction in bath bombs by binding together the other ingredients, baking soda and citric acid, which means the bath bombs with more cornstarch will dissolve more slowly with more fizzes and slower reaction rates.
My name is Tim Yang, school principal. I just want to thank you for joining our virtual science fair. I hope you enjoyed all the wonderful projects that was on display. It was disappointing we weren't able to do this in person, but hopefully we can do so next year. I want to take this time to thank all our science teachers, as well as our students, for putting this project together. I hope you enjoy the show. Be safe and well. Thank you.